guys. Oh my God. Okay.
We have so much to talk about. Let me bring out these wonderful people. First, I'm going to bring out, you guys lined up? Yes? Okay, I know, right? Okay, first I want to bring up EP and showrunner Angela Kang. You're going to love her dress. There she is. Hi, Angela. Grand Poobah, Scott and Gimple. Master of all things, Robert Kirkman. EP. The wonderful EP and director, Greg Nicotero. The lovely and smart Gale Anne Hurd, also an EP. I don't know if you guys like this guy. He plays Rick Grimes. His name is Andrew. I mean, if you're into that sort of thing. Next we have the fierce and wonderful Michonne, played by Danai Gurira. Control. She plays Maggie Ree, Lauren Cohan. Hey, Lauren. This guy's kind of behind bars right now. Let's bring out Negan, Jeffrey Dean Morgan. And last but not least, there's this guy who plays Daryl Dixon. Norman Reedus. Yes! So Norman, you just didn't wear the poncho that you told me you were gonna wear?
I wore it on Conan.
All right. He has a great poncho, you guys. Look for it on Conan. Okay, hi everybody. Okay, I want to start with the wonderful new showrunner this year, Angela Kang. Hi, Pumpkin.
Hi.
You've been with The Walking Dead since the very beginning, so what does it feel like now to step out front and be the showrunner?
First of all, I'm a little overwhelmed right now, that's all, so it feels great. I've been with the show since the seventh episode, the second season. I was a huge fan of the first season of the show. I was watching it, you know, week to week when I was on another show called Terriers, which was short-lived, but... Oh, yeah, it's a great show. But, you know, like, I read that script before it even became a show. I read every issue of the comic that had come out, and when my manager asked when Terriers didn't come back, like, what would be your dream job? I was like, Walking Dead. Walking like, do Dead. Anything you can do to get me on Walking Dead. And, you know, I'm so fortunate that I've been able to be here. I love this show so much, and it's so much fun to work with this cast and this crew, and, you know, it's just...
Everyone has enjoyed you greatly, dear. I have to let you know, I've heard some things, and they just love you. Yes, they do. Gail, what is it like for you to see Angela step in this year as showrunner?
You know, it really is. We sort of, all of us, have grown up together, and watching Angela thrive, you know, she's one of the most beloved people. When she would come on set to produce her episodes, everyone was thrilled to see her. Mm-hmm. But I remember reading the sample script that was sent to me back in the second season, back before the second season. I was like, we have to get her on the show. She is the kind of visionary, the kind of voice. She understands what it is that we're trying to do. And anyway, it's fantastic. Really a privilege.
She's also amazingly humble, you guys. We happened to fly in on the same flight, and I had sat in the wrong seat. I stole somebody's seat. And as I was getting moved out of their seat, sweet Angela comes up the aisle, Yvette, it's Angela. And I'm like, well, they about to put me off the plane, but let me just say hello to you before. But it was so nice that she sought me out, and I should be seeking her out because she's, you know, the showrunner of a show that I absolutely adore. So one more question for you, Angela. We saw Maggie holding a baby. So we can assume there's a time jump now. It finally happened. What does that mean for the story going forward?
Yeah,
Yeah, well, you know, Maggie's been pregnant for
at least 12 years.
At least 12 years, and she finally had the baby. It's been, you know, we are starting with the time jump.
Yep.
You know, doing service to the great time jump that's in the comics. We're playing with time this season. It's really cool to jump forward in the story because we get to see where these characters are at. Like a little, it's been a little while since the war ended.
Yeah.
So they get to kind of start off in a different emotional place. You see that they're really building for the future. And you get to see the world in a way that we haven't seen before. You know, in the trailer, you see that we've got a lot of horses and wagons, a lot of hand weapons, you know, gas is degraded, the roads are crumbling, and it just allows them to have different responses to a whole nother set of challenges out in the world as nature is kind of taking back.
Andy Lincoln. First, I would like to say that I really love your summer cut.
Thank you very much.
You're very handsome. How would you compare season 8 Rick to the Rick that we will encounter in season 9?
Well, yeah, he's had, you know, he's been through a lot of stresses and strains. He's had a tough time. And so he's got a tough haircut to match. my horse really likes my hair, by the way, even if other people have problems with my hair. I actually cut my hair, but not by mistake. But it was Matt Goodwin came into the dressing room, into the makeup, and just said, "Oh, you look really handsome." And I took offense to that. He said, "You look like a country singer." And I was like, "Well, Rick Grimes has never looked like a country singer." So I said, "Get the buzz cut out." So we did this, and it was probably a little bit shorter than it should have been. But by about episode 6, it turns out to be quite a nice haircut. But look, I want to say something because there seems to be an elephant in the room in Comic-Con, and I think many of you may be wanting to ask a question about whether or not this is my last year. Is that true? Now, I did a zombie poll 2 weeks ago, and there were 200 zombies, and I asked them, I said, I'm probably gonna get asked a question, do I confirm or do I deny? Fortunately, that problem was taken away from me by this man. This will
I'm
be-
I'm really sorry, Andrew.
No, I love you. This will be my last season, playing the part of Rick Grimes. Now hear me out, please. I love this show. It means everything to me. I love the people who make this show. I promise not to cry. I've done enough crying on screen. I'm particularly fond of the people who watch the show.
Yes.
You people. And this has been the most extraordinary, amazing, and beautiful experience of my career, and made largely because of you guys and the relationship we have here with you and with you in this room and also in rooms across America and the rest of the world. So I just want to thank you. And I don't want this to turn into an Oscar acceptance speech or an obituary. This is not the point of it. What I want to do is, as you've seen the trailer, we're deeply, deeply proud of the work that we've done this season. I think Angela is astonishing and leading with such class and a light deftness of touch. And it's enabling us as actors to really breathe and deepen the relationships on screen, which we're sort of, I'm talking too much, aren't I?
No, you're not.
Am I talking too much?
No.
Yeah, he's right. I am gonna do it. But I suppose what I wanted to say is that my relationship with Mr. Grimes is far from over.
Yeah.
And a sort of large part of me will always be a machete wielding, Stetson wearing, zombie slaying sheriff's deputy.
Yes.
From London, England.
Yes.
And you know, what a thing, guys. What a thing. I'm really, really, really excited about this season. I think there are two episodes that for me are my favorite episodes since the pilot. And I also just want to commend all of these amazing actors and everybody, the rest of the cast. I think they're doing the greatest work I've ever seen. And this has always been an ensemble, and it will continue to be an ensemble. And no one is bigger than the story, and the story this year is unbelievable. So, is that enough? Do you want to hear any more about the thing? Or should we talk about this season?
Let's talk about the season.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, guys. It was important. We had a little powwow, some of us, yesterday, about what we wanted this to be for you guys and what we wanted this to be for you guys. We wanted to be a love fest. We want it to be a celebration of everything that you guys have created, everything that we love about what they've created. So even though we lose people every year, and this is a huge loss for us as fans, guys, let's just love on what we have left and what is to come. So let's give a round of applause to these wonderful people. To Angela Kang, what's to come. Let's celebrate, you guys. So let's keep going. Scott, hi.
Oh, hello.
Hi, honey. What will set season 9 apart from everything that has come before?
You know, the first 8 seasons of the show were one chapter.
Yes.
Which in some ways, you know, the book was that way too. There was this new beginning. And that's what season 9 is. It's a whole new beginning for the show. It's a whole new show in some ways. And I think people are going to be very, very surprised. They're going to see things they haven't seen. They're going to see a world that is different than it's been.
Yeah.
We did 2 years of All Out War. Mm-hmm. This couldn't be more different than All That.
Great. I love a shift. What's great about Walking Dead is that through the years, you can take it season by season. You can take it 5 episodes at a time. But there's always something that's going to ebb and flow. And I believe we should take this show and also Fear as a piece, the whole thing. So any season is just a part of the puzzle, but we're gonna see the fullness of what it's gonna be at the end. So I love that it shifts and changes like that. I think it's wonderful. Danai? You okay? Too loud. Hi, Danai.
Hey there.
So Rick and Michonne have often talked about reordering the world, right? I know, do you hate the name?
No, I don't hate the name.
Okay, just checking.
It's efficient.
Okay, good. It is. Danai believes in efficiency. Okay, so Rick and Michonne talked about reordering the world. Is that exciting that in this new season you finally get to do that? And my question is, what if everybody's not on board? You guys got a vision. Everybody might not agree.
I mean, that's the thing. I mean, it's kind of a journey. I mean, what is it really exciting is that there was this moment they had in 7-12 where they discussed this. They discussed seeing the end of the Reign of Terror and getting to a place where they could actually...
He's like, hey, yeah, it's me.
You know you.
You look strong.
And actually getting to a place where, you know, we could try to bring civilization back, try to bring order, try to bring people back to community and connection and growth. And so it's really kind of this moment that they've worked for, and then, you know, Carl really solidified it.
Yes, he did.
He said about how we do that, and how there, you know, there has to be something after. Mm-hmm. And, you know, of course, you know, exacting a vision comes with many consequences. So, you know, you see the sort of the byproduct of trying to exact something and lead people towards something when maybe they're not ready.
Maybe they're not ready.
You know, and maybe they're on different pages about how that happens and how it goes down. And so definitely we see the complications. Mm-hmm. They're like teaming up and they're like, you go that way and handle that, I'll handle this. And it's exciting. It's like you're seeing things grow, and when things are working, it's working beautifully. And then, you know, when folks are not on the same page, there's going to be severe conflict.
Yeah.
So there's it's actually really, it's really dynamic. I think it's really awesome what Angela has put together narratively around that.
Yeah.
Around how do you rebuild a world? How do you re-civilize a community of people and bring back things that you're like, oh God, how did they create a constitution? How did, you know, how did they create a charter? How were laws put down? Mm-hmm. You know, what was the foundation of what we just take for granted now?
Yeah.
And so kind of like navigating through that has been a really kind of cool process. But of course, not everybody wants to be civilized.
Oh.
So ..
Spoiler alert. Hi, Norman.
Hi.
It looked like... Hi. Hey, love you, Norman.
Love you, too. It's really bright up here.
I knew they would come out at some point. It looked like Daryl had a lot to say in the trailer. Has he finally found his voice this season? What happened?
Yeah, I haven't said much lately. But this season, for sure, he's got a lot to say. He's that kind of character that has always had that fight or flight sort of attitude, and always felt like his back was up against the wall. So this year, it's a wiser voice.
Yeah.
If you take somebody that has, you know, street smarts, mm-hmm. and you give them time and maturity, they make decisions that'll make you think twice. You know, right. It's like Solomon cutting a baby in half. He's like, this is for you to figure out. So. A lot of that has to do with Daryl and Rick's relationship this year. I've got really good stuff. All of us have really good stuff this year. I mean, Angela's been my favorite writer since she first came on the show. And I've told everybody that. But she's really leading us in the direction that's brand new. I mean, it feels like a freaking Western this year. It's great.
Yeah. Daryl's one of the few characters that we've seen that was not in the graphic novels.
Yes.
So where some people have like a blueprint as to how to create the character or be the character, you kind of came in without that. How did Daryl come to be? How was his disposition chosen, his personality? How did that come to be?
Well, I mean, wow. Right from the first season, I remember Frank Darabont, I said, hey, about this scene, should I do something like this? And he was like, you do Daryl. I hired you to be Daryl, you know, Daryl, do Daryl.
Mm-hmm.
And it was such a gift, you know, to be able to mold something in that direction. And then as the seasons progressed, he went in this direction and that direction. But you ever see that, what's that Willem Dafoe? You, Greg, you'll know. That movie that Willem Dafoe's in that Catherine Bigelow directed way
Spider-Man.
Back? No.
Kirkman.
I can't remember the name of this movie, but there's a great line from Willem Dafoe. And, I mean, they're talking about a girl, but he's like, yeah, the door was wide open. I kind of feel like that with this character. I mean, I've been begging to be in the book forever, but that's never going to happen, Kirkman. But, I
kind of... He just has to be in the novel. He just has to be in the graphic novels.
Yeah.
No?
We'll see.
What?
Probably not.
Probably not. Yeah, I know. I offered to wash your car and everything.
Not after that crack about Angela being the best ever.
Sorry.
I happen to agree, but it still doesn't feel good.
So I apologize. But, I kind of like the freedom to have the door wide open.
Okay.
It's been great.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Hi, Lauren.
Hi.
Hi, Duncan.
Hi.
So, there's a time jump. Maggie's had the baby. How was that for you? Yes, I know you like Lauren.
Yeah, finally, right?
Yes. So, what has the time jump been like for you? How have you reacted to that as a character, as an actress, all of that?
It's been great. It's been really, you know, we obviously left on a pretty sharp note with everybody at the end.
A little tense.
Yeah. So, it was fun for us. It was obviously really fun knowing that I was going to have the baby. I'm sure everybody can kind of sympathize on that. Yeah. But it's interesting going to that point and then filling in all the pieces, and it felt in a lot of ways like you would with a movie, you know what I mean? Like, you know you're going to fill in these spaces, and we get to actually talk to Angela and understand where it's been, and a lot of pieces that were laid down, you know, with Georgie and this book of the future and how it can be.
I love that scene.
I know, it's so inspiring. Yeah. So I just feel like, you know, there's a lot of conflict, but it's conflict between people who love each other that are all working towards what should be a bigger, brighter,
right.
stronger, I sound like a mortgage commercial,
yes.
more fun in the future. But the interesting thing is that this something after that Carl talked about and that kind of a goal that we want to have, it looks different for Maggie, it looks different for Daryl, it looks different for Rick, it looks different for Negan, it looks different for everybody, and that's what we get to dig into. So Maggie mm-hmm. really wants to want all of those things.
Right.
And I want it to be peaceful, and I want this to just be a positive time of growth and rebirth.
But
people are people, and my child has no father.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
The person responsible
is right next to you.
Is a friend of mine.
Right next to you.
But he's not a friend of mine.
No, he's not.
Yeah.
No, he's not. Speaking of that, you know, they say time heals all wounds. Is there any way this could be the case for Maggie and Negan? Will she ever forgive him for killing?
Yeah. Screw all you people.
Come on. What do you think, Lauren?
I think it's going to be interesting because I think we all have ideas about what we would do in certain
yes.
situations and who we want to be and the legacy that we want to leave.
Right.
And when it really, 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 really comes down to it, what do you do?
Exactly.
So that's what the season's about. See you guys later.
Okay. Hi, Jeffrey.
Hi, Darrell.
Did you prepare to play Negan differently this year because he's not the leader, he's kind of a prisoner?
I don't know if Negan knows that yet.
Oh!
No, yeah, it's a different year. I think a different side of Negan. I think we've gotten to see some different sides and little hints of different sides, but this year, just from the trailer, we see that he's in a bit of a predicament.
Yeah.
And he's having to face some stuff, I think, internally as well as outside his jail that he's never had to face before. So we're going to see some different sides. And in saying that, Negan's also getting an opportunity to interact with some people that are up on this stage that he hasn't really had a chance to interact with before, which has been, I think, super fun.
Right.
For myself and Negan.
Okay.
Yeah?
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
I love it.
All right.
Yes. Season 8 had a lot of fights. You and that Rick Grimes.
Yeah, we
had like tussled a lot.
We tussled.
So are you excited to just kind of be in the cell and chill and let people visit you and say hello?
I do like my visiting hours. You know, the thing with Negan, as we all know, is he likes to talk. So it's important that people come and visit him. You know what I mean? What was the question?
Oh, that's good. It was, do you enjoy sitting in the cell?
I don't know that. As an actor, it's been okay. But as the character, I could be itching to get the hell out.
To get out and start some mess. Probably.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. I think there to kind of stir things up.
Yeah. Angela, what can we expect from Negan? You know what's coming. Is there something you can share about what he's going to be?
Yeah, doing? Angela.
Yeah. I mean, well, you know, we're getting to see some sides of Negan that we've never seen before. I think it'll be cool. I'm definitely loving the stuff that's coming in the episodes. I mean, Jeffrey is fucking amazing, and
I love her.
Sorry, wait,
Angela.
Yeah.
Drink.
Yeah.
Angela.
Sorry to the children.
She said you were sweet and genteel. Angela.
I just lost a bet with some people in the office.
It's okay.
It's heckin' amazing.
It's heckin' amazing.
It's heckin' amazing.
Too late.
But you know, like Negan is Negan, and. Negan wants to stir up trouble sometimes, so we will play some of those stories.
All right. Dave Alpert.
Yes.
Hi, Dave. Yes. I love a little applause. What do you think is the most interesting, what's most interesting story-wise for the communities now that the war is over? Like, what's the thing that we're going to be like, ooh?
Well, you know, we spent so much time, you know, tearing the world apart, really sort of seeing how the apocalypse unfolds and the deterioration of society, the loss of civil norms and institutions. I am talking about the show. thank you.
Nice.
So,
very nice.
Nicely done. Nice.
But like in real life, there is hope. And yes. I think what's great is that we're starting to see society come back. It's not a smooth process, and people have to fight to make it work, but I think seeing that stuff come back really is the thing that's been the most exciting for this season.
Yeah. Craig Nicotero.
Hello.
Hi. Yes. As the director of this new premiere that's coming out, what was it like setting up the new world? Because it's completely different now. What was it like for you?
Well, as you guys saw in the trailer, which I got chilled.
Did you get chilled?
I've seen the trailer like 20 times and I still get chilled.
Yeah.
So excited about it. you know, I've always loved the post-apocalyptic world. We never always get to explore the urban setting of it.
Yeah.
Actually, we're in the woods, we're on Crook Road, we shoot the same three roads every episode.
They're all different roads.
They're all different roads, just are named the same road. But, you know, getting a chance to get into D.C., as you saw in the trailer, you know, I read the script that Angela wrote. I couldn't help but think about, you know, the opening of Day of the Dead, where you're seeing the desolate, empty city with just some wind and some walkers, and even, you know, we did a shot that was sort of reminiscent of Planet of the, you know, the last shot of Planet of the Apes. And it's really fun to sort of start designing our world, knowing that people haven't lived in those buildings for a long, long time. To me, that's one of the exciting things. You know, Jeff Shane, our production designer, has done an amazing job of sort of realizing what this future world looks like. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Angela wrote the first script. I would like to say, jumping onto the, how great Angela is, because we do love her. She wrote the first episode that I ever directed, which was the episode that Dale was killed. And it was, I watch that episode over and over again, and it's so powerful, and the performances are so great, such a great script. And I'll never forget sitting in the editing room, and I just cut that scene together, and I invited Angela to come in. I said, come just, I want you to watch the last scene with Dale, when Daryl walks over to him, and they're looking at each other. We watched the scene together, and I turned, I looked, and there was like a little tear coming out of her eye. And she wrote the scene, and she was so moved by it. And I was so proud and so impressed that something that she had crafted, that it moved her so much. So we're in store for a lot of that this year, guys. Yeah. We're in store for a lot of that emotion. You know, the characters that you guys see on stage, we get to see them together. We get to see Daryl and Carol. We get to see Rick and Michonne. We get to see these guys together in these great scenes that...
conversing.
That Angela...
Words.
Conversing.
Oh, sure.
Wait, what does that sure mean?
In scenes together.
Don't gloss over the sure. What does that mean? No? All right, I'll talk to you later. Angela, there are some new faces joining the cast this year. Can you tell us?
There are. I got a cheat sheet.
Yeah, give me a cheat sheet. Let's talk about
There, we have some really cool new characters for comic book fans. I think you'll get to see some familiar faces from the comic come to life on screen. We have joining us Earl the Blacksmith and Tammy Rowe from the Hilltop Community, played by John Finn, who some of you may remember as Critchgow and The X-Files. The wonderful Brett Butler is playing Kip Rose. We have some great, really interesting saviors named Jed, played by Reese Coiro, who's an amazing actor, and Justin, played by Zach McGowan. You saw both of these guys in the trailer. And we have, those of you who know Fantastic Beasts at all may recognize Dan Fogler, who's incredible, and he has joined us to play the role of Luke. There's some other announcements that have been made in other outlets or are coming, so I can't talk about those, but...
That's good. I love it. Kirkman?
Yes, ma'am?
We know a time jump also occurred in the comics. Are there any other elements from the comics that we're going to see on the show this season?
Well, let me just make sure I can talk.
I think you have one more announcement to make.
Do you have
another entirely possible. I think we all may have noticed that seemed like there was a whispering zombie at the end of that show. Which to me is very strange. I want to know what's going on there, but...
that whisper was so weird. Why? Whispering.
We're also going to be we're going to be mining more from the Fantastic Beasts. That movie is going to be the new The Wire for this show. They may recognize Samantha Morton, who's been in Fantastic Beasts and Minority Report, is going to be playing a character that we all know and love named Alpha. You know, there's a lot that comes with that. So there's a lot to be excited about.
Thank you for sharing. Scott, the crossover with Fear was a huge success. Are there any plans to expand the Walking Dead universe even further?
I'm currently in the garage. You're Scott, already rolling your eyes at me.
Scott, because I feel like you're not going to tell me what I need.
No, I'm not going to tell you. But I will tell you, I'm working on something to tell you. I will tell you that we're going to look at the past, present, and future of the show. and some of them might.
Is it past?
Yeah, past.
Like pre-apocalypse?
Maybe.
Could
maybe,
there be a role for a chubby black girl in an air-conditioned room?
Yeah. In Greendale.
Greendale? Did she go to college? I don't know. That was me begging for a job, everyone. Okay.
Gail.
Hi, Gail.
Hi.
Within the landscape of television, it's a big question. What does it mean to you that this show has so many powerful female voices in front of and behind the camera?
It means everything to me, actually. Yeah. I mean, when I started with The Terminator back in 1984,
yeah.
That was rare. Aliens, and it took a while for the rest of the industry to catch up.
Right.
And I think that even back at the beginning of The Walking Dead, you know, following what Mr. Kirkman created, this has been a special universe with powerful women characters on screen,
mm-hmm.
and watching them grow and realizing that they're fully rounded characters, they are not caricatures, is so important for young girls and women to identify with.
Mm-hmm.
And now to have Angela leading us is fantastic. And I would also, because today is Female Filmmaker Friday.
Hey!
I would like to give a shout out to all of the fantastic women directors that we've had on the show. So,
Danai?
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Pumpkin. You and Andy look like badasses taking out walkers while riding on those horses. Was it easy getting back in the saddle?
You don't know. I did learn in season 4, and then my horse was ripped away from me by walkers. But so it was really just one episode where I rode, and I hadn't really ridden since. And then it was like, come on back to Georgia and get back in the saddle. And you know, it's a process. Like, I was really like learning all over again. I can't speak for everybody. You know, we all had our own process. I mean, Andy's really, really good on horses.
That's not true.
You're pretty good on horses.
I think I'm wearing.
There's times he looked like the Marlboro Man. His horse was.
It's the power of pretend. I mean, I think what
the camera wasn't even rolling though.
Well, there were a couple of times where Norman, who have you noticed, is not on a horse this season. The only actor not on a horse. He looks at me, and when my horse, they're not supposed to be on two legs, really, are they? Most.
No.
Mine was. Well, just like. And even Norman was like, dude, get off the horse. What are you doing? But yeah, the thing is, I think I'm a rider that thinks he's actually better than he really is. And the horse knows. That's kind of my style.
You got her there. You got her there. I mean, you know, she was misbehaving and then she started to work with you. But initially she was not happy.
You're really badass. You look so much cooler.
No,
weird name.
No, she does.
Yeah, she does.
My horse is called Sunday, and he happens to be really tall. So that's why it is. He's really long-legged, but he's actually not that. He doesn't like to move too fast. Like, he likes to kind of take his time.
Yeah, like a Sunday.
Yeah.
Exactly. Enjoy like Sunday, it's not Sunday. Okay, it's not Sunday. Yeah. Okay, it's Monday. You gotta move.
Yeah.
But you know, he gets there eventually. But it's just the height. It's just because he's a little
cool. It is so cool being on horseback. I have to say, it's cowboys and zombies this year. And it's sort of the show that I always thought we would get to as well,
right.
You know, from the pilot. And there's just something intrinsically cool about being on horseback, even if you can't ride. You know?
until you have to do take two, and then all the horses have to go all the way back to the beginning.
Yeah.
In the first episode, we had 18 horses, 14 characters, carts, everything that you could imagine. And we would do one take, and it would take, you know, 4 or 5 minutes for the horses to go through the shot, and then we say, cut, all right, let's do it again, and then the horses would poop all through the set on the way back, and you have people running out because there's not supposed to be poop in the set. Then they got to go all the way back to the top and then start over again. So our first episode was a big learning curve. of
about the horses.
Working with horses.
Yeah.
But the beauty of it is, it's kind of like that thing where like, we have to go back in time. Like, there's no way to re-modernize
it. Yeah, there's no forward.
So it's kind of like happening on set and how we had to work with our horses too. Like, we kind of had to do things a much slower way because now they, you know, they had a stake in our story.
Right.
There's a really cool aspect in the first script where if you think about technology and you think about what you need to survive, things that are antiquated, like in the trailer, you see them bringing that covered wagon down the steps. That covered wagon is gold now. You know, any relics that they might find in a museum are actually more valuable than guns because those are the tools that ancient man used to survive. So the idea that our people now have to go back in time to find these tools that were used by ancient civilizations to survive. It's an awesome idea.
Yeah. Speaking of writing things, it's the worst segue ever. Andy, there's a scene in the trailer that shows Rick on the back of Daryl's bike. I wanted to know, is Norman a considerate driver?
I wanted to be the other way around. I was on his lap. And I wanted them to play Madonna, You Take My... No, what's our song?
Crazy for you.
Crazy for you. And unfortunately, I didn't have long enough flowing locks for the sort of wind machine. We had one take like that, actually.
Yeah.
No. Norman is not the greatest writer.
Rick, talk about the thing that sounds like Ely.
Oh, but the wheelie that you
did. Oh, yeah. Tell me about this.
Well, I was... No, I'm on the back, and I chose to do it like this because I didn't want to put my arms around it. Because I just thought it might just be a bit too much for the bromance, you know what I mean? So I put my hands behind like this. Little did I realize it was on quite a bumpy road, and he rehearsed without me, without anyone on the back for safety. And then we did the scene, and I'm sort of, I'm going, pull over, man, pull over! Like this, and he just accelerates it and pulled the wheelie. And I keep going in the scene going, man, so pull over. And he just went, dude, I just did a wheelie.
He didn't even know, though.
And he's still acting the scene. I'm like, oh, I just was really disgusted. I was like, you're really unprofessional. This is gold we've got going on here, and you're getting it. Dude, I'm gonna be in so much trouble.
Norman called me like 5 minutes later. I just pulled a wheelie. I think I'm in trouble. I'm like, did it look good? He said, yeah. I'm like, great. That looks perfect.
That's so cool.
By the way, he texted me to say like, dude, I pulled a wheelie. It's so heckin' awesome.
He called me too. He got called everybody.
Called everyone.
He called everybody. It's his screensaver now. Get on the wheelie, and all you see is my big nose just poking. He goes, we look great. And I went, you look great on the wheelie.
It was, I will say that on Ride this year, Andrew Lincoln can ride a motorcycle.
Oh,
he's
yes.
been lying to me all this time.
Oh, yes. No, that's not really true.
No, you were great.
No,
sort
I didn't.
Of. Jeff was there, he was kind of good,
was,
right?
He was better than we anticipated, for sure.
For sure.
Except for your wife's father didn't like you very much on the motorcycle, from what I remember.
There's a lot of shots of Andy going, what gear am I in?
A mention was made of screensavers on phones. There's also been pictures on Instagram recently of your car, Norman, with the caption, ahem, Andy Lincoln strikes again. Can we see that? Yeah. Can you tell me what had happened?
You know, we just did a really emotional scene that we've been working on forever, and it was a heavy day. And what happens with Andy is when you prank Andy, he gets you back, but he doesn't do any of the work. He has somebody else do it. So it doesn't, I mean, he's really, this whole prank war started, we were in Tokyo, like a million years ago. We were in Japan, and he leans over to me and he goes, you speak a little Japanese, don't you? And I go, yeah, a little bit. He goes, how do I say thank you for having me in your country? So I say, toile wa doko desu ka? And he goes, okay.
Toile wa?
He goes, toile wa doko desu ka? Which means, where's the toilet? Okay? Live television in Japan, that's where it started. And it's been a war ever since. And his last prank, he gets somebody else to toilet paper my car. I mean, like,
listen.
I'm winning the war. You know that?
No, you're not. Remember because he was going on about this muscle car that's
so cool.
So cool. And he just wants to be John Wick of the apocalypse.
Yeah.
But he was going on about this thing and he was arriving that day. And yeah, he was doing an emotional scene. And to be fair, he was amazing. But then he pushed it a little bit too far and he said, "Did you see what I did?" "What are you talking about?" He said, "Did you see? I did the smile cry." I said to him, "Norman, that doesn't exist. There is no such thing in this world as that." He said, "I did it."
It was awesome. You'll see.
The smile cry. And so I got Landon, lovely Landon, to do. I did pay somebody a little bit of per diems to do that. I was on set watching him do this amazing acting, and he kept sending me pictures. I went, "A few more, just a bit more, wrap it more. And eventually he got back, I can't remember what I was gonna say. I can't remember.
I think it's really great that you get someone else to do it because you're like innocently on set. We're all
that's cheap. That's exactly what I was saying. I was too busy.
It's cheap.
And we're all like, "What the hell?" Because it's all wrapped up, like, and you know, he was, you know, you were.
Yeah, everyone left. They were going home, and I'm still cleaning up toilet paper.
That's true.
And he's home.
And that's right. I sent that picture to him, and I said, "This is what you get when you smile, cry."
It was awesome. You'll see, and you'll love it. It's great.
We're gonna open it up for questions. Hi. Well, listen. When it comes to flair, yes, girl. What's your name?
Hi, I'm the button lady.
Button lady. Yes. Give it to us.
Hello, Yvette. Nicole Brown. Do you have your notebook?
It's in the back. I do have my notebook. It's in the back. I adore you. Let's go. What's the question?
Wait, why do they call you the button lady?
Why would they do that?
My friend Elena has an autograph ticket. She's going to bring you guys some presents.
Ooh.
My question's for Andy. Hi, Andy.
Hi, button lady.
You have a fantastic chin. That just had to be said.
That is the best compliment.
I have a fantastic chin?
Chin. You never heard that. It's first time.
That's very weird.
First good chin. For everything. It's a good chin.
It's pretty great.
Thank you very much.
You told us a bunch of things.
That compliment about my chin.
You told us a bunch of things that you're going to miss as you move on. And when Rick leaves the show as a character, however he leaves, I'm not asking. What do you think Rick might miss the most?
That's very, Michonne. Michonne. That was really hurt. Yes.
Michonne
is the final answer.
Okay, we got time for one more question. It's you, baby.
Hi, my name is Christian.
Hi, Christian.
My question is for Jeffrey. In interviews you did for season 7, you talked about wanting to see your relationship with Carl develop.
Yeah, that worked out.
Yeah, we know that. My question is, how do you feel about how the relationship developed and how it ended?
Abruptly.
I mean, look, there was a whole storyline that Kirkman wrote that I was excited to play, and it didn't pan out that way. So it ended a little bit abruptly, as things do on this show.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes we don't know what's going to happen. It's what keeps us on our toes.
Right.
Look, I hope that there is something. I think that relationship brought out something in both characters that we don't see in any other way. And I hope that we find a way for those kind of feelings those character traits that Carl brought out Negan. I hope they're brought out some other way. Does that make sense? Because I think that was a lot in humanizing Negan in particular. Yeah, I don't know what else to say. He's dead, dude.
Stay tuned.
He's dead.
You know what? I want one more question from the audience. Anybody got one more? Get up here. Safety second, kindness first.
Oh,
yeah.
Hey.
Hey.
Button man.
How's it going?
Good. What's your question?
Question real quick. Possibility of our thoughts anyways on Breaking Bad being a prequel to
the It's 100% true. Let's get another question.
If you can't can it.
Right.
If you can't can it.
Totally real.
All right, one more. Oh, it's Michonne. Yes. Go ahead, honey.
I just want to say how much this show means to me.
Oh, honey.
And obviously, Michonne, this gentleman here. We met because of this show.
Yes.
I wanted to. Yes. For those who didn't know.
I knew that.
And I have my own question. He has a question. And my question is, you know, we always get spoiled on awful things. And I just wanted to know if you guys could possibly spoil, are we going to get Michonne Jr. or not?
And get yours in quick because we're running out of time, Grant. Go ahead.
Questions for Andy. First of all, thanks for dedicating like 10 years of your life.
Yeah.
Are you gonna have a hard time moving on from Rick Grimes as a character? And after doing this for a decade, what kind of character do you want to play next?
Oh, wow, thank you for saying that. I'm gonna take a break for a while. It's funny, you know, these guys here and everybody back in Atlanta are the greatest surrogate family I could have wished for. But I do have a real family, and it is time for me to go home, you know? And but saying that, I have one eye on the script. Norman sort of quietly sends me the script. And Danai, that's not a spoiler. That's out now. Good. But so I don't really know. It's been so much part of my life. It's been everything. I've breathed it for 10 years, and I don't really know. But what I do know is that I believe in the story so much that I can't spoil this for you. But this is a really terrific season for Rick's story and Michonne and his relationship. I get to play with all of my favorite characters this year, and they're so good, you know. There are a couple of things that I'm thinking about doing, but I'm so in love with Rick Grimes and the people in this show that I don't know if I can put him down yet.
Yes.
You know what I mean? But the short answer is no, I'm going to bed for about 3 months.
Thank you so much.
Oh, let's give Rick a stand. I want to do a standing ovation.
Yes. This show from the beginning has been just a love fest. Again, these people, all of us that love the show, everything that you brought, Andy, thank you. And everyone that's crossed the path of this show has left something wonderful for us. I want to also say a hello to Melissa McBride. Unfortunately, she couldn't be here with us today, but we want to send her love, and she's here in spirit.